How many of them were live, brother? You know, David vented. Amy. David vented too. So a lot. David vented a lot. Bananas. Yes, we're good. All right, so I'm going to do this. Everybody take out your phone. Ken. Facebook. See, there I am. Share. Share now. See how easy that is? Very simple. And now the gospel is going out to the World Wide Web, and millions upon millions upon millions of people will hear the gospel message. How simple was that, huh? Yeah, you like that? Good deal. All right. Where to begin? I got so many things to say. I wanted to, first of all, as I did my, what Robert has commonly referred to as Bucky's Corner this morning, where I go out and just kind of prep, tell everybody, hey, come back at 11 and 11:30 and be part of a local body. That the Lord has impressed upon me in the last couple of weeks that he is not the author of confusion. Now, I don't know who that's for. I just wanted to be obedient to say that. God is not the author of confusion. If you're going through, and I know everybody here. I was expecting some other people to be here. They're not. I know most of you personally, and I don't know who that's for, but God is not the author of confusion. So if there's any kind of confusion going on in your life right now, know that that is not coming from the Lord. And as we dive into this message today, I don't want to use the term amazing. It just never ceases to amaze me. You know, Ken talked about the tapestry, just how the message last week overrode with the Bible study, and they just intertwined, kind of a part of the theme of what Ken was studying today in Bible study is part of what I'm going to be talking about. And it's just God knows what he is doing. And fortunately, you know, you all are here, and most of you are regulars, but there's so many that come here that aren't regulars. It's not a priority. And I don't want to say it's not a priority for them, but this is a message that's for them. So I hope that it makes its way to them. And one of the ways that that can happen is if you do share, and I know I'm relentless in how I talk about that, but if one person that really needed to hear this, not suggesting that you don't, because, you know, Peter tells us that I say these things to stir them up as a way of remembrance, right? Because there are things that we've heard 1,000 times, but if we hear it or we read it again, maybe the light goes off. And I've shared many times when that's happened to me. And Pastor Scott, you know, said after the first month, or maybe the first message he ever preached, he thought there's nothing else to say. Right? But that's not the case. 30 years later, we're all blessed as a part of his due diligence to continue to give the message. So I want everyone to take an assessment of kind of where you are in your walk with Christ. We're gonna talk today about Gideon and the stages of Gideon that he went through and how we as Christians go through certain stages. God is the same God, the God of the valley, as the God of the mountaintop. And there isn't any Christian ever that's walked the face of the earth that has not been in both of those situations, in the valley and on the mountaintop. And we have to praise the Lord regardless of where we find ourselves. Oh, I never started my stopwatch. That's all right. That's all bonus stuff. So as I was preparing for this message, it took kind of a break, and it was just going through some emails and stuff like that. And there was something that popped up, and I just thought it was appropriate for this message. And this is a tweet or an X that was put out by Elon Musk. And I want you to hear this, because for those of you that don't follow politics and stuff like that, as little as 4 years ago, Elon Musk was the darling of the left. They loved him. He was the greatest thing since sliced bread. He was EV cars, and I mean, he was just the greatest thing since sliced bread. But the minute he entertained the idea of buying Twitter, to open it up for freedom of speech and not suppressing people's ability to be able to speak freely. Woof, the tide changed immediately, like immediately. And it's very unfortunate, but it's obvious. And here's the tweet that he put. The axiomatic error undermining much of Western civilization is weak makes right. Now, I want you to hear that again. Axiomatic. That means self-evident or unquestionable. The unquestionable error undermining much of Western civilization is weak makes right. He says, if someone accepts explicitly or implicitly that the oppressed are always the good guys, well, then the natural conclusion is that the strong guys, they're the bad guys. Very simple, but very true. If weak is right, strong is bad. And so as it relates to us as Christians, I want to encourage you to be strong. I want you to be a strong guy in the Lord, strong gal in the Lord. That's what I want for you. Because if we don't do it, who will? Right? If we don't do it, who will? Turn with me, if you will, to Judges. We're going to start in chapter 6, in verse 11. You've all heard this story 1,000 times, right? But hopefully the Lord's given me something here that you'll take away as a blessing and make you think. Again, I want you to reflect on the assessment aspect of things and where you are in the Lord. Where, you know, are you charting that path of perfection, which is what God intends for us, right? It's what he tells us in Jeremiah. I know the plans that I have for you, they're perfect. But sometimes we don't see that perfection, and it certainly doesn't bear itself out when we're walking a lot of times, right? And we have a tendency internalize and bad things happen from that. So starting in verse 11, it says, and there came an angel of the Lord that sat under an oak tree, which was in Ophrah, that pertained unto Joash the Abizarite and his son. Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, the Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. And Gideon said unto him, O my Lord, if the Lord be with us, then why then is all this befallen us? And where be all the miracles which our fathers told us, saying, did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites. All right, so the angel of the Lord appears to him. Now, I don't know about you, but the angel of the Lord appeared to me, I would stop in my tracks. No mention of that, and we've read in other scripture verses where angels appear and people freak out, and I'm telling you, I'm probably going to freak out. I'm going to be in awe. I'm going to freak out, but no mention of that. And this angel says to him, the Lord, okay, not the king, not the judge, that the Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. Now, you would think if somebody said that to you, that you would stop, you would pause, and you would want to take that in for a second. Say, me? You talking to me? Right? That's not what he said. See, either he didn't look like a mighty man of valor, or he certainly didn't see himself as one, which is part of the problem. And it's part of the problem that we as Christians suffer. That oftentimes, see, God sees us completely different than what we see ourselves. And I have shared this many times. I credit Cheryl Woodhouse with sharing this with me. And it was one of those seminal moments where I know, we were talking about this the other day, exactly where I was in my office, what office I was in my old building. And she said to me, when I pray that God would allow me to see myself as he sees me. And I'd been walking with the Lord for 15 years plus. I had never thought about that ever. Just gloss right over it. And so here, Gideon did not see himself clearly as the Lord saw him. See, he sees the finished product in us. He sees what we are supposed to be. Will we mete out his will through what his vision is for us? And there's many ways that we go about doing that. But in Gideon's case, the first thing he says to him, he says, man, if he's with us, then why is this all this crap going on? Right? I mean, that's basically what he's saying. He's saying, if the Lord is with us, then why then is this all befallen us? And where are his miracles, which our fathers told us about, saying, didn't the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us. The Lord forsook them and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites. We've heard, we've read the stories that Gideon read, or that Gideon heard, but oftentimes we find ourselves in the same position, right? We think about, oh, Teresa's God is treating her right, but what about me? You know, we project that onto other people in the way that their life is going. Oh, Mandy and Ken, man, they got it all figured out. Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. There isn't a single person in here, including our pastor and his wife, that got it all figured out. Okay, we are all a work in progress. Now, there might be some, it's just like a race, right? There are some that are further along in the race than others are. And so what do you do in that situation? You make sure that you buddy up with individuals, right? You surround yourself with godly people. There is a recipe for the success that we are looking at. One of the issues that Gideon, it's so funny because he talks about, you know, he knew that the Lord brought them up out of the land of Egypt, right? He knew that. He said, I've heard the stories. Where are the miracles, right? Well, how about the Asherah pole that's in your father's garage? How about the altar to Baal? Did he not tell him about that? Because clearly, Gideon was aware of both the altar of Baal and the Asherah pole. Two things that were clearly evident, but where was Gideon's mind in that? Because all he could think about is me, me, me. How come I'm suffering? Well, because you've got some sin in your camp that you need to take care of, and I'm telling you, you're the guy to get it done. And that's what he's saying to each one of us. Each one of us is called. We are called, and God is looking to equip us to be able to deliver people from the bondage that they are in. But the onus is on us to want to accept that equipping, and that equipping comes by showing up at 10 o'clock, showing up at Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock, making that sacrifice. We talked about sacrifice earlier today, and it made me think about Eric, and I've shared this many times before, but for those that have not heard it, when we used to do a Friday night Bible study at our house many years ago, when Eric started coming, it became so important to him that there was one time in particular that he was in Palatka, Florida. I don't even know. I can't even spell Palatka. Where's Palatka, Eric? St. Augustine. Okay. He was in Palatka. And you know what he did? He made sure that he got back in his car after a long day's work and drove back so he could be at our house at 7 o'clock on a Friday night for Bible study. That's a sacrifice. That's a sacrifice because it was important to him. And so for these guys, every year during the harvest, they would work out, man, they had a good, strong harvest, and then the Midianites would just roll in, and they'd take it all. The Israelites would just sit there and complain, oh, why is this all befalling us? I think about, I try to impose myself into the scriptures, and I think about how my life was pre-Christ, B.C. And I remember one time in particular, I had a pattern that I used to go through in my life. And I remember I was mowing the lawn, and Mary had just come back. We were yet to be married, but the clock was ticking. I had asked her to marry me, and she had accepted. And I just, the Lord just said, man, you need to go bare your soul. And I remember walking up to her as she was just right on the curve of our sidewalk or the walkway up to the front door. And I just said, hey, listen, I need to tell you who I am. So I can go for long periods of time or certainly short stints and do very, very well. And then all of a sudden, I'll do something stupid to mess it up. I'll do that. And I just want you to know, I don't want to do that anymore. And I think I've gotten decidedly better at not doing that. Because at that time, I was so dependent on my mother because I had never gotten out from underneath her wing. I became dependent upon her. I could do my own thing for a while, and then it was, can you bail me out? And she would always be there to bail me out. And I got to the point to where the thoughts in my mind were such that I couldn't survive without her. And so I have been able to overcome that. But I know that there are many Christians that similarly will sabotage their walk. They'll get going, they'll get plugged in, and then something happens, and then poof, that quickly, they extricate themselves from the thing that got them to where they were. It wasn't what they were doing here that caused that. There's something else that caused that, the wheels to fall off. And so it's on us, folks. It's not on God. It's on us. It wasn't on God that the Midianites would come into the camp and steal the harvest. It was because of the way that they were living. Follow with me. Go on to verse 14. It says, and the Lord looked upon him and said, go in this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have not I sent thee? Verse 15, he said. And he said unto him, O my Lord, wherewith shall I save Israel? Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. And the Lord said unto him, surely I will be with thee, and thou shalt smite the Midianites as one man. Here is a guy who was sitting under, he was hiding from the Midianites just to eke out his meager existence. And an angel of the Lord appears unto him and gives this to him. And what does he do? Instead of being overjoyed and say, I'm ready to go, I'm going to go roll up my tunic and let's go, he starts to give him excuses. He says, listen, my family, don't you know who I am? My family's poor, and I'm the least in my father's house. And that is exactly the same thing that we do. As Christians, we allow ourselves to come up with excuses to limit and to put God in a box and want to blame God. We look at other people and say, boy, they got it right because we've got these machinations that we make up in our mind about how perfect somebody's life is. And I can assure you that's not the case. And when you start to plug in such a way that people will open up to you, then you will realize, just come to a couples meeting, fourth Saturday of every month. Come there and see the honesty that takes place and the transparency that takes place. Why? Because we know the importance of marriage and how under attack it is in this country. So we get together and we openly tell people what some of the issues are that we have and how we've gotten through them, because we know people that are young in marriage are exceedingly susceptible to divorce over the craziest and strangest things, and we don't want that to take place. The Israelites had sin in their camp. Now, I'm not saying there's small sin and big sin, but there is small sin and big sin, but sin is sin. And for one person, they might be dealing with something big, whereas another person might be something a little smaller. Not saying gossip's not a big deal, but it might be a big deal for you. And how you know, if you're one who is a talebearer and you stir up strife, man, that's going to bring some stuff back on you. I promise you that. If you talebearer, you are going to sow strife, and that's not good. Sean, pull up Psalm 81 and 13. I don't have it down here, but I want you to read this with me. Psalm 81 and 13. This is how simple it is, folks. This is how simple it is. Read it with me. Oh, that my people had hearkened unto me, and Israel had walked in my ways. What would happen? I should soon have subdued their enemies and turned my hand against their adversaries. Say amen. That is the simplicity. God's word is true. And he's saying there, if you hearken unto my ways, I will subdue your enemies. What are your enemies? What are your enemies? The adversary, the accuser of the brethren, the one who wants to keep you down, thinking, oh, I'm the least in my father's house. Tell that to this guy right here, because that didn't work for him. He wasn't buying what the devil was selling, right? Can I get a witness on that? All right. How about the bartender and the bone collector? They weren't buying what he was selling. How about the inmate that turned to Samson? Ah, yeah, I remember. Listen, if you can grab hold of what the scripture says and seek to meet it out, you can't just say it and expect it to happen. And I think that's what happens a lot. We name it, we claim it. And man, that you can't do that. You actually have to do the work to get there. And that's why I get so angry when people say, well, there's no work involved. You're saved by grace. Yes, yes. But once I'm saved by grace, there's a lot of work. Okay, there is a lot of work. And it takes effort to get to that point. But that's a mindset. That is a mindset. You have to have that mindset that if I hearken unto his ways, that he is going to subdue my enemies. I want to stand on that promise because I don't want to have to deal with my enemies. The battle is not mine. The Bible says the battle is the Lord's. Where does it say that? It says that in, I've got it here, I swear I do. It says Deuteronomy in 20 and 14. I know I'm getting ahead of myself, Sean. I'm sorry. For the Lord your God is he that goeth, what? With you. With you, not for you. He does it for you, but he goes with you. We're partakers in the battle, right? But it's his. It says, to fight for you against your enemies, to save you. That's what God wants to do. He doesn't, be careful here. He doesn't want us to struggle. Now, what I mean by that is it's not to say that we won't struggle. Okay, but that struggle, the trying of our faith works patience, right? Think it not strange when you fall into various trials. Okay, so we know that we're going to fall into various trials, but those trials are for strengthening us, for helping us. For Sister Kay to go through a trial might be a benefit to Sister Amy when she gets to that point, because they know each other and they can talk, and Sister Kay say, well, I've walked in those shoes. Let me help you get through that, because I made some mistakes when I walked through that trial, but I don't want you to have to go through that same thing. But those struggles that we go through are really for our benefit. But for us, back in the first part of this chapter, chapter 6, it talks about how when the Midianites came down, do you know where the Israelites went? They went into the caves. The Bible refers to them as caves, as strongholds. And many Christians find themselves in caves today, because of the battles that they face, because they're not equipped properly to know the word of God that says that if you hearken unto my ways, I will subdue your enemies. They fight these battles and find themselves in caves. And I don't know what your battle is, but what I know is I don't have to worry about somebody coming in my house and stealing my Cheetos, right? That's not my battle. My battle today is between the 6 inches right here. It's the battlefield of the mind, which is what Brother Ken talked about this morning. And I don't know what it is for you. I wrote a few of them down. Self-image. Do you know that almost 70% of high school girls, 70% struggle with depression because of their self-image? 70%. 7 out of 10 girls struggle with depression. And we know where that ends in a lot of cases. Self-image, lust, guilt, doubt, bitterness, unforgiveness. Those things that can take root, and man, are they hard to pull out. Man, are they hard to pull out. And what happens a lot of times, it's like, you ever get the, well, of course you do. Like in our driveway, we'll have the little gap between the pieces of concrete. And so I'll get in there because that grass comes in. Sometimes I just go and I nip it with the weed whacker. But you know what that does? Makes it grow back a little more robust. It's a little stronger. So now I've gotten to this point where I get out there with my pressure washer and I just spray them and I get them wet. Why? Because if I get it wet, then I can pull them out by the root. Because if you just pull it out and it's dry, sometimes you can get a little bit of it and then pop. Oh, and you're like, man, the root's still in there. And that's what happens a lot of times. I think we say, oh, Sister B, I'm sorry. That's it. But we didn't really address that unforgiveness or that bitterness or whatever it is that we're carrying around with us. We didn't pull it out by the root. Therefore, we're still struggling. We're still dealing with that battle. I don't know what your cave is. I don't know if your cave is sitting in front of the TV for 6 hours gaming it up. Sometimes that's a cave for somebody, right? I know there's competitive gamers. I don't think we have any in here. But alcohol, pornography, drugs, eating. There are so many different caves, and it's different for every single person. And we allow ourselves to be held down by the Midianites, forcing us into the caves, into those strongholds, when we have the power available to us to get out of the cave, kick the door down, and say, no more, devil, no more. And that comes from us pouring into the Word of God. And I'm just going to ask you, are you a David right now? Or are you a Gideon? And if you're a Gideon, what phase are you in? Because Gideon had a few phases. And I will tell you this, when I was studying this out, the area that Gideon was in is the same area that David was in, same valley that David was in 130 years later. And Gideon was saying, oh, my giant's so big. And David was going, what? You're going to curse my God? Just think of the difference in attitude. And listen, I don't want to pile on to Gideon because he certainly has his place. But there were kind of three phases of Gideon. Phase number one was he's the coward. He's, you know, he was a coward. He didn't know. He didn't want any part of that. But then in chapter 7 and 8, he became a conqueror, right? And he conquered the Midianites. I remember years ago, Brother Junior preached a message called Break the Pitchers. And that's what they did. That's where this came from. They broke the pitchers, and the shining lights scared the Midianites into confusion. Folks, we break our pitchers, and our light shines. And that's what we need to do. We need to have our pitchers broken so that our lights shine. But unfortunately, towards the tail end of chapter 8, he became a compromiser. He said one thing, but he did another, and there's a lot of us that do that. Your actions speak much louder than your words. I've preached that to my kids since the day we adopted them. Your actions speak louder than the words, and people know that. I used to have a license plate frame that said, the best sermon is a good example. Because it's not what you say. Because we all talk a good game, right? We all talk a good game, but do you live a good game? And if you don't, there's hope. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day where you can turn that around. When we arm ourselves with the Word of God, when I say arm ourselves, it's a battle. When we arm ourselves with the Word of God, we can become, what's available to us is to become a mighty man of valor, to become a woman of virtue. That is what the Word of God avails us. But we must pour in and allow His Word to have the desired impact that it has. Back to the battle of the mind. That, for us in the modern day church, that is where it's, especially here in the United States of America. Now, I'm not saying in other parts of the world that they aren't dealing with that, because clearly they are. We still have genocide going on in places like Darfur. There are places around the world where there's civil war and strife. It's pretty safe to say, I would say that even in the next 20 years, that's probably not something we'll ever have to deal with. Now, I don't know. We're in a pretty vulnerable position right now. But politics aside, I think it's safe to say that I might have to worry about going and getting a cold thing of water out of my refrigerator. I don't have to deal with that. My battlefield is right here. It's these 6 inches. And for everyone in this room, that is where your battlefield is. And so, again, in the spirit of Peter, it bears repeating 2 Corinthians 10:4-5. It says, for the weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal. Our weapons are not going to be a sword. It's not going to be a gun. That's for defense. It's not. The gun isn't going to help you against the enemy. It's not going to help you against the enemy. They are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. That's where they were hiding. That's where the Midianites had them run to, the strongholds, the caves. It says in verse 5, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought of obedience of Christ. Okay? This young man right here cast down that. Hey, I'm the least in my father's house. He cast that down. The bartender cast down what the enemy was selling. She wasn't buying anymore what the enemy was selling. Neither for the bone collector, neither for the inmate, and neither for a lot of you in this room. You're not buying what the enemy's selling, right? And this is how we do it. We take authority through his word. If you are a Christian, there's likely a war going on inside of you. Now, there's wars and there's battles. But I promise you, no matter what stage of the game you're in, Pastor Scott still has battles that he contends with. He still has things that he has to overcome. Now, the better you get, the easier it probably becomes. But there are times when you need to leave. Look, David had Jonathan. I mean, and Saul was trying to kill David, right? But his own son was an encouragement to David to get him through some difficult times. The importance of having good, godly fellowship. So I think that this is, knowing that, that this is what Peter had in mind when he penned this scripture in 1 Peter 2:11-12. It says, behold, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lust. And I know when we hear fleshly lust, we think immediately of, you know, like pornography or something. Listen, insert whatever that fleshly lust is. I don't know what it is for you or what it was for you, but abstain from that. Get away from it, which wars against our soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Folks, don't just talk a good game. Don't just be a hearer of the word. Be a doer of the word. Do what you say. Say what you do. That is what that scripture verse right there epitomizes that. So they're going to try to say, oh, man, I know you. I know what you did, but no, let your good works glorify God, which is in heaven, and let him get the credit for that. That's what we're called to do and is being done in this church. This church has had such an amazing impact, to places that you will never know, places that you couldn't spell. How? Through the internet, before virtually any of you were here. We were doing Pastor Scott's messages on shortwave broadcasts that were going to Uzbekistan and stands that I don't even know about. Lives were being changed. Lives were being changed. I think of the Kimberly Home and the Florida Baptist Children's Home and the Stepping Stones Farm that's not even there anymore. 27 girls that was their last chance before they got sent to jail. And just, man, I'm not waving our own flag, but the Lord loves a proud doer. We've done some great work in this community, and it's because of the people that are in here. It's not just Pastor Scott and Sister Shelley. It's not just Amy and Sean. It's collectively as a group. We've got to hearken unto his word so our enemies will be subdued. And when you're going through a struggle, make sure you're involved. Make sure you're part of what you're doing. I'm so excited for these young people to see that. To have such a heart for the Lord, to want to worship, to want to learn, to want to be a witness to other people. It's just so invigorating to see that. It's so awesome. If weak makes right, so we started this whole thing with, if weak makes right, then the strong are the bad guys. This is what I want you to leave with right here. Ephesians 6:10. It says, finally, my brethren, and I want you to know, I did a search. In the King James Version, this is the only place in the Bible that this phrase, be strong in the Lord, is found. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Anybody want to know what the next scripture verse talks about? The whole armor of God. That's exactly right. So I want to charge you to be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. And how do you do that? You pour into his word. You allow it to be applied in your life. You listen to when Sister Mandy's up here. You listen to when Pastor Scott is up here. You come to Bible study at 10 o'clock on Sundays and 7 o'clock on Wednesdays. And if you've got a significant other, you come to those couples groups. And if you've got an addiction or you can lend some advice about the addiction, you come to that recovery group. You come Wednesday at 6 o'clock if you can do that. Because that is how we are going to even take what we have out into this community and have a greater footprint. Would you stand with me? If there is anybody that is going through any confusion or you just need somebody to talk to, there are so many people here that want to talk with you, whether you're whether you're young or you're old. Yeah, that's Asian. Whether you're young or you're old, it doesn't matter. There's somebody here that wants to talk to you. And I promise you, I know the way God has woven the tapestry of Crossroads Chapel, that I don't think that there's anything that you have gone through or could be going through that someone in this body with as few people as that are here have gone through. Because I've heard just about most of it, and there's nothing that we can't tackle together. So I want to encourage you that if that's on your heart today, that you stick around and either come up to see me or whomever you know. Don't hold that back. God is not the author of confusion. He does not want you to be bound by anything. And you have the power. Come out of that cave and make sure that you know that God is going to be with you as you fight that battle. Father, we just thank you for this time today. Lord God, I thank you for the hearts that are here and for the work that you're doing. I thank you for a godly pastoral team and those that support the pastor from the teaching and the ability for them to go for 2 weeks and know that the pulpit is secure, Lord. We thank you for the provision for that. We thank you for the provision for this body, Lord God, to be in the best financial position we've ever been in, Lord. Pastor Scott often says, we don't need their money, and we don't. We trust you, Lord God, because you provide what we need. And as we leave this place, let us go with the injunction and the commitment to know that if we follow your ways, that you will, it is a promise, you will subdue our enemies. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you for your time. Reach around, greet somebody.